see many of you today, and many of our new members also came today as well. It brings me great joy, so thank you. And I hope you and your families have weathered the severe cold weather these few days. Everyone's doing okay? No issues or no damages?
Don't ask anybody
to ask. And I hope all of us are staying committed to our daily Bible readings.
Yes.
Show of hands who's reading it.
We're out of time.
Wonderful. And also the reflection on God's Word and the weekly exercise. Let's pray together before we start. Our Heavenly Father, we are just so grateful and thankful to have this, our church family, that we have this church family whom we can depend on and to pray for one another. And we gather together just to feel this togetherness before you and to really come in the attitude of worship before you, Lord. We are so thankful that you have given us the passion and desire to know your word and learn from your word, Lord. So, Lord, teach us today. Holy Spirit, move around this place. Fill this place and fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit, that we would understand the difficult things of the book of Job, and that we would be able to, in the end, really worship you in the end, as Job did, Lord. We thank you, and we praise you, and we dedicate this time to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Video. Maybe there's no sound. Give a big hands to Tiffany who's making this video. You can find the one with the sound in our Facebook webpage. So, yeah. And she plans to make one for our sermon this Sunday as well. So we're so grateful to that, Tiffany. I know many of you might have questions reading through the Book of Job. Right? It's not an easy book. Who had difficulties reading it through that? Yeah, we all have difficulties. It's quite dark, right? Quite gloomy, sad, and the conversations between Job and his friends can be really challenging to understand. Yeah. In fact, even seasoned preachers like Charles Spurgeon devoted a significant amount of time to it. You know, Spurgeon preached 88 sermons on the Book of Job. And our Methodist founder, John Wesley, has his own notes on the Book of Job. It's not an extensive notes, but he has notes on each chapter of the Book of Job. We know of John Calvin. He preached 159 sermons on Job and delivered every day over a period of just, you know, under 6 months. Now, in the 17th century, a Scottish Presbyterian by the name of George Hutchinson preached 316 sermons on the Book of Job.
Crazy.
But the winner goes to Joseph Carroll. He was a Puritan, lived in London. He preached 424 sermons on the Book of Job alone, taking 23 years to preach through the book. So it's like your grandchild visited your church and he came back in 23 years and the preacher is still talking about you. Your grandchild is now in 40s and, you know, and grandpa, are we still studying through the book? Now that's not going to happen here in Comanche. Don't worry. It's my hope and prayer that we go over and study together as many books as possible. But we do want to take some time on the Book of Job, and we want it to be a monthly Bible study. And I really apologize for my situation this year. I have to really dedicate significant time in my dissertation. But in our monthly study, we want to dedicate some time on the Book of Job. So the question of why me? Why did this happen to me? We know that this question has echoed through the centuries as people grapple with pain, mourn loss, and endure hardships. Whether it's emergency surgery, you get a call and say someone related to your family has cancer, terminal illness, the sudden loss of possessions, the death of a loved one, the rebellious children, or setbacks in various aspects of life, these adversities are shared experience for all of us. And if only we could clearly see the connections between our sufferings and why these things happen, it might be easier for us to accept it, why we face such challenges, right? But more often than not, problems arise without clear explanation. It's not a clear-cut mathematical equation, 1 plus 1 equals 2. And something doesn't add up and does not make sense. Why does these things happen to me? And when we cannot link our troubles to specific acts of wrongdoing, we feel that the afflictions are undeserved. So this cry of, what did I do to deserve this? Really opens the story of Job. This book provides a potent example of undeserved suffering. In a short time, Job lost everything. His possessions, children, his health. His friends accused him, and God seemed absent. He's completely silent in his distress. And the book of Job has captivated people across ages, drawing them near to read it because many find comfort in identifying with Job, whose suffering was prolonged, very unfair, and incredibly intense, making it a compelling read. But at the same time, it is a bit terrifying book to read as well, right? Because it talks about stuff none of us really want to go through. Right? We don't want to go through that. So as your pastor, my goal is to help you through this study and address us any questions we may have about the theme of unjust human suffering. And also each study that we do together should ultimately bring glory to God. Amen? So ultimately, even in this difficult case of Book of Job, in the end of our study, we should be able to praise God like Job. And that's my hope for you. And each of the 66 books should do that. That is the philosophy of my preaching, and we want to do the same thing. We want to understand God's attributes, His mercy, His love, and His mystery through this book, and so we can ultimately give all the glory to God. Amen? Of course, this book is not easy. You know, in the introduction about Joseph Carroll, who preached Job for 23 years, in his final sermon said, "I have still not attained a clear understanding of some of the passages." So it's a difficult book, and there are aspects of God that may not make sense and will never make sense. But my hope is that this book draws us closer to our Creator, and ultimately we find comfort in His goodness and love for us. And I want this to be kind of a sharing time as well. We want to kind of go through this question, and please feel free to share any of the question here. Kind of a self-examination here. What do I most want to know about suffering? So, what do I most want to know about suffering?
Will it end?
When it will end, yes.
When will it end?
Yes. That's a very good question.
Why, right? Why does this happen? My loved ones.
Why does it keep happening?
Why does it keep happening, right? And not just me, but around the world.
I just think it's part of the human condition.
Yeah, part of the human condition, yes. Sure. Part of the...
Being human.
Right, being humans. We are subject to suffering. And many times, it happens out of the result of the human faults.
You think it's just testing us?
Yeah. We may have a question about, is it testing us? Right? Is it, are we going through a time of testing?
Well, if you read Job, it's kind of like, you know, the devil and God talking, and he says, okay, well, watch this. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't believe me? Watch my tracers. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll show you this guy. I'll stand up to it. And the devil says, well, all right. Mm-hmm. And goes in and makes him suffer. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was kind of disconcerting to me, because at that point it seems like God's abandoning him to the devil, and then we'll come back and, you know, we'll save him because he had confidence in him.
That's right.
That doesn't make Job feel any better for the years that he suffered.
Right. It's eventually we'll get there. That's the question we all kind of have. When I experience suffering or see someone else suffer, what one thing bothers me the most? What one thing bothers you?
That I can't help them.
That's it. That's it right here.
What was that, Linda? What?
That we cannot help them. There's nothing we can do. What else?
The same they're taking or we're taking in. Pain.
Pain, huh?
Sometimes guilt.
Sometimes guilt, right? The guilt maybe is happening because of me or something like that.
Well, empathy is another one.
Empathy, yeah.
Empathy.
Right.
You know, sometimes it overtakes you because you don't understand why it keeps happening.
Right.
Another thing is we can't help as humans think, what did I do to deserve this? Even though we know that's not the case. Mm. It's not something we've done that's causing the suffering. Mm. But I think it's part of being a human being, you can't help but think that.
That's really kind of a Jewish way of approaching it too. You know, because, you know, as you read through the Jewish people, you know, they say, okay, God, you know, I did this wrong and now you're going to punish me. You know, because there is so much punishment throughout the Old Testament.
I think Warren definitely read this.
But that is the Old Testament way, right? Testament way, once the God was a
another frustration is with me is just get over yourself.
Right.
Just you know, don't wallow in this.
Right.
It's just a part of life.
Right. And how about if that someone is someone whom you know as maybe it could be me, right? It could be a pastor, right? Or it could be someone in the mission field. Who's doing God's work, right? If suffering happens to that type of person, what would you feel? Why him, right? Why her?
Yeah, because they're supposedly good people.
What is my most common failure when suffering comes into my life? What would be that?
Like doubting God.
Doubt God, yes.
Patience,
right? We lose patience, right? Lose the temper and our emotions.
I think there's a degree of fear also.
Yes, fear. Fear captivates us. Right? And we sometimes say, does God even exist, right? Does God even exist?
No.
No.
Okay.
Be careful not to be angry.
Right, be careful not to be angry.
A lot of people dwell on the past, and that's not good.
Right. And we could be in a kind of a stance of negotiating with God. How can you, kind of a sense of betrayal, right? I've been loyal to you, God, right? Why I can, how can this be, things happen to me? These are all the questions. Being honest, describe your view of God during times of suffering, especially if the suffering is undeserved. I think we already talked a lot about that.
I have problems with that because that's assuming God has given us the suffering.
Mm.
And I think we bring it on ourselves most of the time.
Mm. Right, that's great, yes. Sometimes we bring it on ourselves, yes.
Who decides if it's undeserved?
Mm. Right. That's who decides it? That's right.
My first
right.
thought was that God showed a weakness, that almost a human trait, sometimes, like we're talking to Satan and letting him influence him, but even listening. That was my first thought. I had to come back in and rethink it.
Thank you for the wonderful sharing. I would like the session to be like this. But let's talk about the summary of the book. Who can tell us something about the book? Just anything about the book? Or if you could give a short summary of the book, what would be the short summary of the book?
Well, I know I've amused my friends somewhat by saying Job had the worst friends in the world.
Job had the worst friends. Great. How many friends did he have?
Three.
Okay. Yeah. All right. What else do we know from the book?
It all ended well.
Okay. He had great perseverance.
Right.
We know where the patience of Job came from now.
What kind of man was he? What kind of man was Job?
Righteous,
blameless.
Faithful.
How about his wealth status?
Very wealthy.
Okay. And what is going on that Job doesn't know? Only the reader knows.
He doesn't know. That it's the devil. He thinks it's God.
Right. He doesn't know anything about the conversation between God and devil, right? We talked about the three friends, right? Engage in a long discussion with him, right? And they try to explain what has happened by connecting Job's suffering with his sins. And, of course, Job rejects their theory. And afterwards, we have a new character, Elihu, appears and makes four speeches. Does God ever talk to Job in this book?
At the end.
Not in the beginning or the middle, but at the end, he himself personally encounters Job. And what was Job's reaction at the end? He repents, right?
He's contrite.
Right. He surrenders to God.
But he had his say
first. He did.
The date of the book is the patriarchal setting, about the time of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. There are a number of reasons why I think that I would put him around the time of Abraham or a little before, because first of all, Job's wealth is measured in livestock, isn't it? Right? He had lots of animals. We see in the video the same way Abraham and Jacob's wealth is measured in livestock. A second one is the apparent absence of the mention of Moses, right? Or the law of Moses. In the prophets, they always talk about this law of Moses or the as the kind of a elements of national life in Israel, but there's no any reference to the Exodus or other later events of Israel's history. So must be before Exodus. And without a priesthood or a sanctuary, only the Levite priesthood can offer sacrifices. But Job himself offers sacrifices to God in a patriarchal fashion, like Abraham did, Isaac did, and Jacob did. Job's age is also consistent with the lifespans of the patriarchs. He's in the end of the book, his age is about 200 years or older. We can figure that out. So it's about same with Abraham and during those times. That's why in our daily Bible reading, Job is placed before Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12, who comes? Who appears? What character? Abraham, right? Abraham. Right? So this is why Job is placed right before Abraham in chapter 12. So it's a chronological reading, the daily Bible reading. So you will find it very helpful.
Do you believe this is the oldest book in the Bible? Because that's indicated by some.
Right. I would put him, you know, very close to the time of Abraham and those stuff. But the story of the Genesis story from chapters 1 to 11 definitely happened before the time of Job. Outline of the book, we'll talk about the outline of the book, is mainly divided into three parts. It's Job's distress in chapters 1 to 3, and Job's defense from chapters 4 to 37, and Job's deliverance in the last chapters. And Job's distress is really, it talks about his prosperity and his adversity and his perplexity. The important one is really the body of the outline, right? Body of the outline. And every time you read the Bible, you want to kind of see the big picture of the outline first, because it will definitely help you when you're reading it. Because in the body of the outline, that's from chapters 4 to 37, that's the majority of the book, right? And what happens here is really the three cycles of debate between Job's three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar, and Job's reply. So Eliphaz goes chapters 4 and 5, and Job replies to that. And second one also, Job replies to that. And then there's a second cycle again, and they do it again. And then there's a third cycle. Okay, so what is the accusation of the three friends? What are their kind of a theology?
That Job sinned.
Yeah. That Job sinned, right? Yeah.
And not being honest.
Right. So they're saying Job must suffer so much because he sinned, right? Is it true?
No,
definitely not true, right? So you have to understand that it is the word of God, right? But not many times they're right. Okay, so majority of the portion that you're reading it, don't fall for their ideology or theology, because they're wrong. Their accusation is wrong. You know, sometimes they make correct statements such as, you know, God is merciful. You know, God can forgive sinners. God can restore sinners. Is that a true statement?
Sure.
Yes, right. But are they applying it in the right case here? No, right? You understand what I'm trying to say? So you have to kind of determine. You have to take the good from what they're. So they can be saying the true, you know, statement about God, but applying it wrong in Job's case. Right? So you have to be very kind of determined to distinguish their kind of an accusation here. So we don't want to believe everything they say, but take some days, you know, some of the things they say. So it's a very tricky book. This way it's a very tricky book.
I thought in chapter 4, verse 8, where he said, as I have observed those who plow evil and those who sow trouble reap it. Mm. Don't we say things like that about people?
Right.
You're getting what you deserve.
Right.
So I had circled that one because I thought that is so true. How many times have I thought that?
Right. And sometimes it is the case, but sometimes it is not, right? In Job's case, it is not. But so they're saying it, you know, against Job. So that's why they're in the wrong here. But sometimes it is the case that what we saw, what we read. So they have a bad theology here. So Job's has a bad theology. You know, you must be a sinner. You know, that's why you're suffering right now, right? So, we want to deal with that kind of slow. We are not going to get to here today, but in the months to come, we want to let's take it slow, okay, one at a time, and you know, let's go into this book.
So can we go back to what Warren and I were talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that the perception of the Old Testament God, mm-hmm, that you sin and you fail?
Right, right.
And if you don't sin, then you reap.
Right.
And so aren't they expressing what is the common perspective in those days about God?
Right. That's right, yes. It is a very common theology in the minds of the Israelites, the people during that time. And not just Israelites, but around the world during that time. They had that type of theology and perspective about God, even the people of Israel. But it is fascinating that God is exactly refuting that from the very earliest account of the Bible, right? He's saying, I'm not that type of God that you think, right? So it's from the earliest account in our entire Bible, God is refuting that idea, and he's really telling us who he is.
I think it's a stretch to call these three guys his friends. No, I think they were his contemporaries. They were also wealthy guys. They were in the same similar situation to him. And I think their discussions with him were, you know, hey, it's not happening to me, and I'm not doing any of these things. Not happening to this other guy, and he's not doing any of these things, so obviously you are. You know, I don't think that they were coming to him as a friend. They were kind of rubbing his nose in it.
Most people, maybe I shouldn't say most people, but many people, the only way they can elevate themselves is to push the people around them down.
Amen. Right. Yes.
Good point.
Right. But initially they suffer with Job. They kind of grieved with him when they came. So it might be their real intention was to, you know, grieve with him, but then, you know, kind of a later kind of that mentality overtook them, or you know, actually they really wanted to maybe help him out, to really, they wanted to get well, so they're throwing out those bad theology. Sometimes we do that too when we, you know, visit the hospital and yes. Stuff like that. We the best thing to do is to be silent, right? And just to hear what they say, right? But we kind of say something in hopes that they would help them, right? But in fact, it does not.
And they were not listening,
right?
Because he was not,
right.
He was not saying that I haven't done anything. Mm-hmm. He's saying I don't know what I did, and that's what I'm for God to tell me is mm-hmm. what did I do to deserve this? Mm-hmm. So he had that same theology, that mm-hmm. same philosophy. Mm-hmm. He was looking for an answer, I think, and they didn't hear that.
Yeah, I just in the discussion, it's kind of like this tells me how really hard it is to change somebody's mind once they get an idea in their head.
That's correct. And we have to be humble, right? So sometimes, you know, there's ideology or theology that you know we've been inherited from the past, but we have to be humbly think that if my ideology or my thinking is in line with God, and we have to be humble enough to change that if that makes sense. So let's go to chapter 1. So in the lastly, God humbles Job, and I didn't mention Elihu. And you know, once again, it's a very misinterpreted book. This is a very difficult book, and even I think many scholars get it wrong too. You know, even some people say that Elihu is not no different than those three friends, but I'm going to argue that he's really God sent, and he teaches Job those things. And Job doesn't argue with him, just like he did with the three friends, and he listens. So Elihu is a God sent from God, and to teach him the wisdom of God. And then after Elihu comes, Job, God humbles Job here. God humbles Job. Let's go to chapter 1. Sin 1 is the man of who Job is the man of. Let's go to chapter 1, verse 1. Chapter 1, verse 1. In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. Right? What are the four characteristics that is describing Job here? He is
blameless
and upright.
Fearing God.
And shunning evil. Blameless, it does not mean that Job is perfect or sinless here, but it means personal integrity. You know, Job's first recorded act is to offer sacrifices for sin. Right? He does this because he knows man cannot be sinless. Right? But you know, it is possible for sinful man to be genuinely good. Okay? That's what Job was. It may be rare, but it is possible for a man who genuinely loves and obeys God. It requires tremendous effort, but Job had made that effort. And he had a tremendous personal integrity before God. Upright means straight, you know, in the sense of not deviating from God's standards. So it means a faithful obedience to God's statutes and an honest, compassionate manner also in relating to other people. He was upright in the sense he was honest with God, faithful to God, also compassionate with others. Job feared God, feared God. And fearing God is the very attitude that every Christian must possess. Now we talk about fearing God. It's not about being scared, right? Like hiding under the bed scared. But it's more like recognizing that God is way bigger, right, and more powerful than us. Is that recognition. So a person who fears God puts God first in every aspect of life. Because God is not thought of as an equal, right, or an inferior to us, but an all-powerful, all-knowing, and constantly thinking that He is everywhere present in our lives. So fearing God is like in awe of His greatness, right, as a creator, and submitting ourselves to Him in our daily lives. So we have to ask this question, am I fearing God, or am I just considering Him as one of my equal, right? Am I recognizing Him as way bigger and more powerful than us? Job lived his life with this mindset here. He didn't fear God like some terrified, but he acknowledged God was superior in every possible way. So every day, Job made sure that his actions brought glory to God. The fourth one is Job shunned evil. And he was also made a conscious effort to avoid evil in his life. Job understood this and made a daily practice of turning away from sin, right, and turning towards God. Right? This act of turning, repentance, was a constant part of Job's life. Repentance is turning from evil, turning towards God, right? It happens that there are times that we may be losing sight in the sight of evil. But what is important is that we turn away from it and are going towards God once again. Job constantly made that effort to avoid evil in his life. Saying no to sin isn't something we can do on our own. It requires really the help of the Holy Spirit in our heart. So we must, when we start the day, right, we read the Bible, we read during our daily reading plan, and I ask you to pray briefly, right, you know, picking a verse that of your favorite and kind of pray at the end. And you want to start the day by really humbly asking God's help. Lord, I do not have the ability to shun you, but with your help, with the help of this Holy Spirit, I can do that. So we want to really wake up and start our daily life being in a humble posture and humbly asking God for help, guiding us throughout the day. So Job was aware that sin was at the core of it, anything, and that might lead him away from honoring God. He was always watchful against temptations from the flesh, the world, even the devil. He took steps to avoid unnecessary contact with the fallen world. You know, carefully chose his close companions and actively worked to eliminate known sin from his life. In chapter Job 28, verse 28 says, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to shun evil is understanding. But Job had both, right? Fear of the Lord is wisdom, shun evil is understanding. We have to really know this. True wisdom is a combination of knowing God and knowing ourselves. And knowing God is fearing God, right? Fearing God. And knowing ourselves, shunning evil, our own nature to actively avoid sin. No matter, you know, we don't care, you know, how the world defines wisdom. The Bible already defined wisdom for us. The true wisdom is the combination of fearing the Lord and shunning the evil. You know, it's a combination of knowing God and knowing ourselves. And on this verse, John Wesley noted that this is the best kind of knowledge or wisdom to which man can attain in this life. And Job exemplified this by understanding both God and his own nature.
I thought in here it says he was the greatest man among all the people of the East.
Uh-huh.
Then you go to verse 22 and said, in all this, after he lost his family, all of his livestock, everything else, it said, in all of this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. That pretty well sums up the first chapter.
Yes.
I mean, he did away with everything he had, lost his kids, and then he did not charge God with
with
killing.
Exactly. Yes. That's it. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Job's wealth here. Job's wealth. Job's wealth. Verse two. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Right. So 10 children. Right. Verse three. And he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 5,000 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys. And had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. You know, Job possessed enormous wealth. So being hailed as the greatest of all the men of the East, you know, and having this wealth, the greatest wealth. You know, having wealth itself is not wrong, right? But the scripture constantly warns against our desire, love of money, right? The warning is rooted in the understanding that putting money above principles can lead to moral downfall, as seen with Ananias and Sapphira in the book of Acts. Notably Judas, right, who valued 30 pieces of silver, more than a clear conscience towards God. Right? And we know that Jesus also emphasized that we cannot serve both God and money. Right? So while wealth obtained and used rightly can be a blessing for God's glory, but dangers like self-indulgence and greed lurk nearby. So scripture criticized the misuse of wealth, not the possession itself. And, you know, like our John Wesley also said, gain all you can, right? Save all you can, and give all you can. Right? That's really the posture we should have. And also one very important thing I want to mention is that we need to recognize that wealth isn't always a sign of God's blessings. God has reasons for blessing some with wealth and others with less. We have to know that. And now clearly Job was blameless and upright in the management of his personal possessions as well. Let's look at verses 4 to 5. His example. His sons used to hold feasts in their homes on their birthdays, and they would invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. When a period of feasting had run its course, Job would make arrangements for them to be purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. This was Job's regular custom. You know, Job's godly character shines through here in his genuine concern for the spiritual well-being of his grown children. Right? Every year, after each of his 10 children celebrated their birthdays with parties, and Job's birthday, you know, Job took the time to offer burnt offerings on behalf of each one of them. And this might not be something that you would do, right, after a big family birthday party. Right? It's even hard to get everyone to have a time of prayer, have a short time of worship. But for Job, it was a priority. He seized these moments here to intercede for his entire family by making offerings to God, including likely himself. Now, and so Job's children weren't just enjoying the perks of their father's wealth, you know. They were being instructed in godliness from a very early age. And the act of burnt offerings showed that they were taught about sin and the need for forgiveness from their earliest ages. And he actively did that. So in that sense, Job exemplified not just wealth, but also wisdom in nurturing a godly family here. He was a godly father. Now let's go to the interesting sin, the sin number 2, the heavenly council, from verses 6 to 12 here. So imagine a heavenly council meeting, right? Verse verse 6. Let's read verse 6. One day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He's blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." So imagine a heavenly council meeting where the angels are giving updates to God. You know, on a particular day, these angelic beings, also referred to as the sons of God, gathered before God to share what they've been up to. Among them was Satan, who mentioned that he had been moving around and walking on the earth. The most likely, it seems like he was on the lookout for individuals he could accuse, right, and harm. As mentioned in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, it says, "Be alert and sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour." That's what Satan does, roaming throughout the earth, trying to devour someone, trying to accuse someone. So Peter advises us to stay alert, watchful, because our enemy devil is actively seeking to do that. Now let's learn something about Satan here. Okay, so Satan is a singular person. Okay, it's not, we don't say that there are multiple Satans. Okay, so he's a singular person, not multiple. There were originally 5 cherubim kind of angels. They are higher ranking than the ordinary angels. They are special celestial beings and guardians, the very guardians of God's throne. So they made sure no intruders to the throne of God. So Satan was originally a cherub, even above these 4 cherubs here. But Isaiah and Ezekiel talks about the pride led Satan to try to rule on the throne of God. So he rebelled against God, right? And so the book of Revelation talks about Satan leading 1/3 of angels to rebel against God, but they were all cast down from heaven to earth. And that's why they're roaming kind of throughout the earth. So you could call these fallen angels as demons, and demons who follow and serve Satan, the singular figure here. Now, people mistakenly understand that Satan and his demons are in hell right now, but they're not. They're actually not in hell right now. They're roaming around the earth, you know, seeking people to devour it. And Satan still has a access to heaven and can be stationed before God. So who is in hell right now? We call it a hell or the Hades. Those are the unbelievers. Every person who dies immediately go to one or the other place, right? Heaven or hell. The Hades is where the unbelievers die and go. They're in that place right now. When the believers die, they go to heaven, right? But they are not the eternal place that we will dwell. We talked about that. We will dwell in the new heavens and the new earth, right? God's gonna bring the heaven down, right? It's a heaven and earth, the merging of heaven and earth, new heaven and the new earth. That's where our eternal destination is. But our temporary dwelling place is in heaven right now, where all the believers are residing now. Same thing, the hell, there will be eternal lake of fire. God has preserved the eternal lake of fire for Satan and demons and unbelievers to go forever and eternally. So we can understand it in that sense. In the Bible also calls Satan the prince of the spiritual powers of the air, and uses various metaphors like a serpent, right? Dragon, lion, tempter. Bible calls Satan a murderer who was seen from the very beginning. But here's the key point I want for us to know, is that Satan is, when we think of Satan and God, we think kind of terms of rivalry. But it's that Satan is not a match for God. It's not a close competition. You know, sometimes we might, you know, imagine a dramatic battle between God and Satan. And it's very important to understand Satan is just a created being, just like other angels. God is a creator. Right? And this created being is much smaller, weaker compared to the creator. And he can only do what God allows him to do. Right? And in the grand schemes of things, he's more of an annoying man than a powerful adversary in the divine assembly. So while Satan may cause mischief, his power is limited, and God ultimately has the total control. So don't misunderstand, Satan is some type of rival power of God. Now look at verse 6 here again. It says, you know, they came to present themselves. Angels came to present themselves. It means positioning oneself before someone, like awaiting orders. This is like a military term. Military colonels meeting with a general to discuss tactics and receive final directions. So what we are seeing here is that angels, including Satan, are stationed before the highest commander, God, here. And when God questions Satan about his actions, Satan simply reports. Right? He doesn't speak first. He reports that he was roaming around the earth. Right? It's showing that Satan, like other angels, is subject to God and must give report for all their actions. So Satan cannot do anything without God's permission and approval. And he is essentially quiet and silent when he is positioning himself. And what's important is that Satan is not the first one who brought up about Job. Who brings it up?
God
did, right? God brought it up, right? Satan cannot even mention Job until God invites him to do so, you see? So the fact that God initiates the conversation further shows us the subordination position of Satan in the divine order. What God says to Satan, right? And you consider my servant Job, verse 8. There's no one on earth like him. He's blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. Even God acknowledges that, right? Not only the readers, but God acknowledges that Job is blameless. He's a righteous man, right? So, it's as if God needed to boast before saying, you know, I'm winning and the victory is mine, Satan. Have you seen Job? Now, I want us to see something very important here. Just remember the story of the Garden of Eden for a second. Right? It was here where Satan, the serpent, right, seemed to gain victory by tempting the first humans, Adam and Eve, and introducing sin and curse into the world. Right? And the sin brought calamity and curse upon the entire humankind. In a sense, Satan was very successful in tempting the human beings. Right? But in Genesis 3:15, God revealed, we mentioned it many times, right? God revealed to Satan that there would always be godly seeds and offspring of Eve, from woman, who would stand against the seeds of the serpent. Right? Job was one of these godly seeds of Eve, and his life served as a demonstration of true godliness. So he was someone who was blameless, upright, fearing God, shunning evil. And just imagine how proud and joyful God must have been, right? Watching Job's life displayed before the Creator's eyes. Right? Just how proud and joyful his life was to him. Job became a living testimony to God's claim that there will always be individuals who, despite until the coming of the seed of the woman, the Messiah, there will always be individuals who, despite the challenges and temptations, who will remain faithfully and godly before God. Now think about it. Many people ask this question, right? They ask, why God even made a forbidden tree that presented the possibility of humanity falling into sin? Why does even God do that? And the simple answer I'm going to give you is because God loves us. Because God loves us. And let me explain what I mean by that. He granted us free will, right? The ability to make choices, right? Consider this. Would you prefer to be a human or a robot? Humans, right? Humans. Robot simply follows the instructions programmed into its system, right, by its master. Doesn't have any freedom to choose and act independently. On the contrary, we, the humans, possess free will, right? We are free to make choices, to act as we wish. We are free to make choices whether good or bad. And this includes the freedom to love God or to choose not to love God. The essence of true love is voluntary, isn't it? Think about someone who loves you deeply. You wouldn't want to force that person to love you, right? Would you? That's not a true love, right? You wouldn't want that type of love. True love is someone, when someone willingly, sincerely, and authentically chooses to love you for who you are, right? That's the definition of true love. Our God, in his great love for us, desired this authentic love. You see? He doesn't force us into loving him. Instead, he gave us the gift of free will, the freedom to choose. Just as you wouldn't want someone to love you under compulsion, God values our genuine voluntary love. He wants us to choose to love him, to embrace a relationship built on truthfulness and sincerity. And by giving us free will, God allows us this beautiful opportunity to willingly and genuinely come to him and express our love for him, right? Creating a bond that is authentic and true, see? So the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is an expression of God's great love for us, not the other way around. Do we understand that? Right?
Yes.
So that's exactly, precisely what God wanted from Adam and Eve. God's desire was for genuine love from Adam and Eve, not a love forced or controlled. He wanted true affection there. Now, this is very important. It is something, you know, the Holy Spirit always moves and to gives me the understanding as I'm preparing it. But now think about Job, right? Job was a man who made God so joyful, even in the aftermath of Adam and Eve's fall, right? The sin and curse already entered the world, right? Meaning Job's love for God was absolutely and entirely out of his own choice. Right? Just think about it. Unlike the pre-fall state of Adam and Eve, Who will be more difficult? The pre-fall state in Adam and Eve, will they be more, who will be more easier to obey God and love God? Adam and Eve, right? Because it's before the sin entered the world, right? Job lived in a post-fall time, right? His time is after sin had already entered the world. Satan has had claimed partial victory over humanity. You know, we have to understand that in this post-fall state, following God becomes far more challenging because sin has already permeated the world, right? Satan's temptations are everywhere, more severe, and human inclination always tends toward evil. That's why in the time of Noah, right, in Genesis chapter 6, when the humanity populated and sin kind of permeated throughout the world, you know, when God saw the world, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth. And that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. Right? Far more challenging to love God out of their own choice in this post-fallen state. Right? But in the face of adversity, Job chose to shun evil. He feared God, maintaining his moral uprightness, and he loved God. And by observing Job, God was essentially saying, he's the symbol of my trophy of victory. See? Just think about how immense and tremendous joy that Job's life brought into the eyes of Creator. This is a powerful message to Satan. He's saying it's not the end of humanity. God always preserves the godly, the seeds of woman. And Satan must have looked at Job as God's trophy of victory. See? So this is a lesson for all of us. How our actions and commitments bring so much joy to God's heart. That God would even initiate this conversation. That he's so joyful that he would do that. Just imagine God boasting about you. Just as he did about Job. You know, have you seen my son? Have you seen my daughter? There is no one on earth like him or her. He and she is blameless and upright, person who fears God and shuns evil. But remember, God takes great delight in your commitment to him. Amen? So, with that in mind, you know, remind ourselves of the goals we set for ourselves. Thank you so much for committing your time, spending time with God, the reading your Bible. Right? The doing our weekly reflections, weekly exercise, right? Takes about 30, 40 minutes per day. But those time is so precious to God that your commitment to him, your devotion to him, brings so much joy and delight in God's eyes. And we want to continue to do that. We want to continue to bring him immense joy and glory. So So God delights in you, rejoices in you in heaven. He claims victory, saying, "My son, my daughter, you are the trophy of my victory." I hope that God is saying that to all of us. Amen. Let's take a break time, 10 minutes, and then we will be back.
He's a pretty good guy.
He's testing me out. Pretty good. It's torturing. Well, I think sometimes in our lives we do get
older. We begin the second part of the session. We want to finish by 12, so everybody can have lunch.
Have snacks, have lunch.
Yep, you can have second lunch.
Second breakfast.
Now, going back to the conversation, right, with the Satan, right? How does Satan answers God, right? In verse 9. If you look at verse 9, it says, "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied, "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? We have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." So what Satan does, we have to understand, is Satan's aim is to always destroy our joy in God. Right? That's his job. That's what he always wants to do. And he attempts anything he can do to destroy our joy in God. And there are two ways that he can do that. Two weapons is pain and pleasure. Okay? He uses pain to make us feel that God is powerless or hostile. Right? When someone suffers, you know, we kind of feel that, "God, why aren't you not doing anything about it?" Right? Why, you know, we feel that God is powerless. God has no power over the sickness, suffering, or the pain in this world. That he can do nothing except for just watching it. So that's the sense that he can put us in our hearts. He uses pain to do that. He also uses pleasure to make us feel that God is extra and unnecessary. Right? When we have the pleasure, when we have everything, when we have all the desires we want, there is no need for us to find God. Right? God seems extra. Right? That that's not fearing God, right? That we feel that God is inferior to us. We already have everything. Right? But Satan had failed to turn Job away from God in the days of his pleasure and prosperity. Right? In the time of his pleasure, when Job was the greatest man, right? He had the greatest wealth. But in the times of his pleasure, he was upright, blameless, fearing God, shunning away from evil, right? So he couldn't attack him with the pleasure, right? That's why he is now trying to use pain to Job to turn him away from God. So pleasure didn't work. The first weapon didn't work. So he's going to now try to use the second weapon, the pain and suffering. Now Satan's character is that Satan is the accuser. And Satan plays the role of the accuser in the heavenly courtroom, acting as a counsel for the prosecution. And he's a prosecutor. He's the accuser. He is relentlessly bringing damaging charges against God's children, seeking to totally destroy us. And that's what he does every single day, every single minute and hours. There is not an ounce of goodness in Satan's character. We have to know that. His every action is bent on one thing, our total destruction, and his immorality and evil is just surpass our understanding. There is not an ounce of goodness in Satan's character. And we saw how he accuses Job, right? He is accusing Job in verse 9, saying, "Does he fear you for nothing?" Does he fear you for nothing? Meaning, does Job serve you for no reason? That is, does Job fear God or worship God on the basis of what he materially gets out of the relationship? You see, he's accusing him there. Meaning, does God buy worshipers through material prosperity? Satan is suggesting that Job was serving God not out of pure love, but only because of what he received from God in return. See? So the question is, will Job be seen as one who will serve God even if he gets nothing in return? I mean, will anyone serve God for no personal gain? Does man serve God to only get blessings? Or do we worship God simply because he's God? Right? You have to think about that. And Satan is very clever in doing every attempt to accuse Job, isn't he? It is a question to accuse Job, but we still need to deeply ponder on this question for ourselves. Are we worshiping God simply because he's God? Or are we serving him or worshiping him to get something out of him? Right? We have to really ponder on this question. We come to worship God on Sundays, not because we can get something out of him. Amen? Right?
Amen.
We come to worship him simply for who he is. It's because we know deep inside of our hearts and through the revelation of God's word that God is infinitely good, infinitely beautiful, infinitely gracious, and loving, right? That's why we come to worship God, right? God delights in that type of worshiper, and I hope we become that faithful man and woman of God who serve and worship God just because of how beautiful he is.
Amen.
Now, Satan is a dangerous accuser. So, firstly, he's accusing Job. Right? Now, just take away Job's prosperity, then Job will curse you. Right? He's a prosecutor in the court. He's taking charges here. And his righteousness will crumble to dust before your eyes. Subtract what he has, and you will see him for what he truly is, a cursing, self-centered man. Right? Job is nothing but a selfish man. It's like a gaming machine. If you put a coin, the machine gives rewards or gifts in return. Right? Satan is saying, Job would no longer insert his coins of worship if nothing came out of the machine. In other words, Job was worshiping for selfish reasons. He's a selfish man. So you see what Satan is doing. He's accusing Job's very person here. Right? He's the accuser. That's what he does. He brings charges against every individual in this world, he brings charges. And he's describing Job as a very self-centered and greedy man. But many people miss seeing that Satan is also accusing God here. Okay? Satan is also attacking the integrity and goodness of God. Because Satan is suggesting that the only way God can get people to worship him is to promise them wealth. See? Let me explain the terms of my relationship with Abby. Right? Abby loves me because of who I am, right? Hopefully. She loves me because deep inside, I'm an innocent, good man. She loves me because I'm someone who is gentle, very considerate, a polite person who sincerely loves the Lord, right? And the poor young lady is willing to come to Comanche to spend time with me. I mean, who am I, right? I have no savings. The poor young minister who loves the Lord. And please don't misunderstand. I'm not undermining Comanche in any way. But you have...
She has a wonderful opportunity to come to Comanche.
Yes. Well, you have to understand, the young people really love cities, okay? I've been to Irvine, California to visit her. The weather is just absolutely perfect. You know, there is Green Mountain. I love to hike. You know? It's blue
safe,
sky.
It's safe.
Blue sky and ocean. Moles everywhere. Yeah, right. There's moles everywhere. Fancy restaurants. It's like heaven for young people, okay? So I deeply appreciate her for coming all the way here. In a sense, it's a sacrifice to support my ministry. It's not an easy step, but a big sacrifice. Well, let's say some person comes and say, hey, you're mistaken. You know, Abby loves you because she wants to get something out of you. You know? She loves you for money. She doesn't love you because you're deep inside Because you're not deep inside a good and genuine person. What did he just do to me? That would be an insult to me. They would be an insult to my integrity and goodness, right? That's precisely what we have to see here. We have to see here, Satan is not only accusing Job, but he's accusing the very center of God's person, you see? Satan is also accusing God by saying, God, don't be mistaken. Job does not love you and serve for who you are. But the only way you can get people to love you is to give them money. Promise them wealth, health, and prosperity. You see? He's also accusing the very, attacking the very integrity and goodness of God here. Okay? So let's look at God's response. God's response in verse 12. Verse 12. The Lord said to Satan, very well then, everything he has is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger. So the Lord accepts the challenge. And the one other thing that we want to, we don't want to forget to see the thing that we mentioned before, that we, one thing we have to clearly understand, that Job's life brought tremendous glory and joy to God, right? And in the end, we will not understand everything, right? This is just the beginning of the month. We, you know, we are not covering everything today, okay? So hold on to your questions. We'll go through all that. But in the end, we have to accept that God can also use Job's suffering for his glory. So God received so much glory and joy and delight in the person of Job that he chose to love God. Even in this post-fallen state, he chose to love God and chose to shun evil and love him out of his own choice. And even after his suffering, in the end, he repents and surrenders before the will of God. So that brings glory to God. God can use suffering for his glory. And we will get there. But one thing we learn about Satan is here, once again, Satan is not a rival to God with equal standing, right? What is happening here? Satan, in verse 12, God allowed to touch all that Job has, but not Job personally. Right? Don't touch him personally. And, you know, we are going to kind of wrap here, but for those of us who might be kind of scared of demonic powers, who might be a bit intimidated by these spiritual forces, I want to close with an encouragement by reminding you 2 points from our study today. The first is avoiding obsession with the demonic. Okay? Obsession with the demonic. We can be terrified, very intimidated by looking at the conversation here. But we know from today's study that Satan constantly accuses believers, and one potential error we can fall into is that we can make too much of Satan's activity. We can be too obsessed with that. You know, some Christians become so obsessed with the demonic power that they lose sight of their security in Jesus Christ. Right? So we have to remember that the battle has already been won, right? Through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? And we are called as light and his children, held securely in God's arms. It's very essential to maintain a balanced perspective and not let the focus on spiritual warfare somehow, you know, lost in the assurance found in Christ. You know, Satan plays the role of the accuser. The Bible says Jesus Christ is not only our Savior, but he is also our advocate. We know Satan brings charges against us. He's the role of a prosecutor. But on the other side, there's Jesus Christ standing before God the Father, acting as our advocate. He stands in our defense, interceding for us before God the Father, that God the Son does. He assures us that despite the accusations and challenges that Satan throw at us and throw to God, we have the ultimate defender who speaks on our behalf in the heavenly realms. We have to remember that. That's why Romans chapter 8, verses 31 to 34 say this. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? Right? Who will bring any charge? Not even Satan. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. And Christ has already done that on the cross. And when Satan tried to bring accusation about us to God, our Christ, the advocate, is standing and saying, no, he's already forgiven. Right? He's already covered with my righteousness. Right? He stands at as a defender. Verse 34, who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Amen? So remember that there is the accuser still alive until the day he will go into the eternal lake of fire. But we have the defender, the advocate, and also the Holy Spirit in our heart, guiding us, leading us, constantly telling us the peace of mind, that we are securely held in God's arms. Secondly, we must recognize God's ultimate power and control. Right? The opening chapters of Job highlight a crucial point that any power Satan displays is permitted by God, right? He doesn't even speak first, right? He has to give reports to God when God asks him, right? Satan is not described as a rival power to God. Satan has no power over Job or his possessions until God permits it to him. See? So our lesson that we learn from Job, among many, are the all power and authority belong to God. The one in total control of all things is not Satan, but God. Right? Satan holds no independent power, but he is essentially a tool in God's hands. So remember that God's power and control over your life is absolute. God is the one who controls our life, not Satan. So there's nothing to be worried about. And find comfort and rest throughout the week and in the assurance that God is the ultimate authority over your life. I know this is just the beginning. We're going to go through it in the months to come. We'll still have a lot of questions, but by the end of our study, I can assure that we will have a better understanding of God. We will have lots of our questions answered by the end of our study. Please pray for me that this year is very critical. I have to write a dissertation. I really want to do it every week, weekly basis. But this is my only chance like this year, and school is giving me the final chance to do it, to finish it this year and next year. So please pray for me. But you know, these materials and all the preparation, I spent a lot of time, you know, contemplating on it, praying about it, and even the sermon, you will notice that, you know, I want to make it perfect. You know? Sometimes there in the side of me saying, Jay, you have to work on dissertation. You have to, you know, just a little laid down a little bit, but you know, there's a bigger side of me saying, no, I want to give perfect materials to my congregation, you know? And it just takes a lot of time and dedication. So let us end this with some of the questions I have for us here, some applicational questions here. You can kind of look through those and kind of you can share some of the questions like we did in the beginning of the session. So take a few minutes to kind of look at them. Anyone would like to share? You can pick a question.
I want to respond to number three from Mitzi's point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Her insurance, Aetna pulled out of California, so she's had some real challenges again with getting appointments.
Mm-hmm.
And her response was, it's a challenging circumstance, but her response was, God has always taken care of me. I know He will. I just wish I could understand why He lets it be so hard.
Mm-hmm. Mitzi is still remaining in trusting us for
yes.
sure.
Uh-huh.
And that's what brings glory to God. Yeah.
So comment for me on number four.
Uh-huh.
I've heard people encourage praying for your needs.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard people encouraging only to pray with thankfulness for the things that we get.
Mm-hmm.
How does that interact with number four? Do we worship God simply because He is God, or are there times when we worship? When our worship is influenced by personal desires, to substitute prayer instead of worship, do we pray simply because He is God? Or are there times when we pray when our prayer is influenced by personal desires?
Right.
Can you comment on that?
Right. Just like our relationship with our, you know, father and a child, right? God is our father, right? We can, of course, our father knows the desires of our hearts. As a child, as a young child, he knows what we want. He does give us what we want because he is a gracious and loving father, right? But in a sense, we cannot lose track of that. Me and the father is not in a kind of business relationship, but really, I love my father because of who he is. Right? I know my father provides for our needs. It provides for my protection because he's my father. But at the same time, as a child, we love Father. We love God because of who He is. So, of course, it's not wrong to ask for these things, but there are times that when we are too captivated by those and really lose sight of who God is. We ask these things because we know God is infinitely good, merciful, loving Father, right? Not because He's a genie who jumps out of the lamp and fulfill all our wishes, right? As long as we have the sense of the fearing God, right? That Job had, the shunning evil, that God, acknowledging God is all powerful, acknowledging He's way bigger than us. And we can ask for these things in line of what in God's will. But there are times that prayers, our desires may not be in line with God's will. But of course, as a gracious and loving Father, He desires us to pray for our needs. He wants us to do that. And He will graciously fulfill that. But at the same time, we want to truly kind of ask ourselves the question, what Satan said, right? If I get nothing in return, am I going to still love God? Right? We have to ask that question. And the answer should be yes. Right? The answer should be yes. No matter my prayers doesn't answer, no matter I don't get the desires, what's in my heart, I was still going to praise and worship and love God. That should be our
Jay, I have a comment on six,
mm-hmm.
which is how does this perspective impact our daily actions and choices?
Mm-hmm.
I look at it this way. Our commitment to God, to make bring him joy mm-hmm. is the least we can do mm-hmm. for everything that he has done for us.
Yes. Yes. Right.
That's
right. That's right. Right. The commitments that we make, you know, this daily devotion, it's, you know, I know it's hard. You know, three chapters, four chapters, reading it daily, it can be very difficult if it's not, you know, out of our habit. Right? But it should have been given. Right? The 30 minutes, 40 minutes should be devoted to God, but to bring Him delight. But it can be very challenging. It can be very hard. So I want to encourage you to, if you haven't caught up, don't try to, and if it accumulates, right? It accumulates every day, the things that you haven't caught up. Don't try to dwell on that too much. Just do today's portion. Okay? Do today's portion and think about catching it up later. Okay? Later, or, you know, maybe I want to catch up one of them in the evening or something like that. But don't dwell on that accumulation of the one that I missed. At least just dedicate today to God and do the today's portion and really make that commitment to God that will bring immense joy to God's heart. And really I can say relate to that. I mean, Job's, his life brought tremendous joy and glory to God. He's so joyful that he is claiming victory over Satan, right? So Job's life brought so much glory to God. We have to remember that. And can I, right? Can my life be bringing glory to God and joy to God's heart? Anyone else?
I appreciate the number two, the 28, that fearing yes. the Lord is wisdom. That's, I've never heard it put that way. I've never recognized that in reading that when you read fear of God, when you fear God, you are, it's wisdom, it's understanding God's role and who yes. he is and what he is.
Yes.
It's not fear.
Right.
It's almost respect.
Right.
And respect and love.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's good. I like it.
Yes, and it's just amazing how the Bible defines wisdom in that way, right? Tremendous, right? Remarkable. The way is contrary to how the world defines wisdom, right? I've already defined it in the beautiful term. Fear of God is wisdom. Okay, let us spend some time praying for what we've covered today. And let's pray for our church, pray for our worship service that will continue to bring joy and glory to God through our worship service. And really, that I want to dedicate my life to God this year. That I want to bring glory and joy to God, just like Job did. Right? I want my life to be that. Right? Just pray over many things that we have covered today. And pray for our church. Please pray for me to have a wisdom and dedication to write the dissertation this year. And pray for your personal needs. Personal days before God. You may be going through challenging times, suffering, right? Ask God for help, right? Ask God to help you in this journey, okay? So let's take some time to pray together. We pray about 5 minutes, so just can pray silently or out loud, anything that you'd like to do.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. I worship Your holy name. It's a new